what is a man without his crew? Can you make these moves alone to make a dream come true? Nah, that's like smoking alone with no one to pass to. Asking for a favor, then you can expect the last two. Cashing in my favors, calling in all the troops. Filling my food with a few of the illest cats to ever do it. Let's
keep this. Yeah, so the summer had just ended. I felt like everything was falling apart. All my expectations that I had were absolutely decimated. And I just didn't know what to do. So everything was all up in the air. And this is really around the time that I think both me and Adam really started collaborating with other people. So we ended up meeting this other artist from Royal Oak, who called himself at the time Dollar Bill, and he was putting on shows, he was putting out music, and a liquor store that we actually would go to up the street from where Adam lived, we ran into him because he would always put flyers up, and he was handing out his CDs, so we ran into him, we got a CD from him, and, you know, we connected, we linked up, and he was putting together his next album, and he was, you know, trying to collaborate with other people, get a bunch of local artists on it. So he put us on a song called Pass the Mic.
Spit flames to get the mic burning, puffin', exhaling certain words, turn into a perfect version of lyrical murder. So it's Team 4th Street at your service. Encourage the crew with the best determined word. These are the MCs, didn't see the Wizard of Oz for their brains, heart, and courage. Y'all heard it for one, cause all I ever think about is number one. The world don't revolve around me, so I'm jealous of the sun. And two's better than Uno, able to lead the rest in their best dress at a funeral. Killing these tracks, puff, spit, soup quick, hit the mic, can't come up in the studio.
Bastard soup up in this hoe, what you gonna do when I spit it like that? See me posted up with my bitty cock back. Got an S on my chest, King Superman's back. What can you do when I get on the track and I spit in a verse and I'm killing them fast? Easy to see, I am the best, Mr. Incredible. Got the eye on my chest, coming for the top cause I am in the game. And you know I'm a beast and the damn thing changed. I am no lame, king of the crew. Bury a click, ain't a thing but to do it, so don't pursue it. If you're trying to compete, all I need is a skillet and I'm frying the beat. Trouble Way Productions, the 4th Street Heat. Home of the best rappers you can find in the streets.
Damn, Zoom, promote the mic from your lips. You almost killed that.
And this would probably be the last song that we were referred to as Stereo Killers together, and definitely one of the last songs that we recorded as Stereo Killers.
You took me for fuck what I'm not, fuck what you've done. I'm a piece of glass and a Tootsie Roll, just handed to your son. I'm not done till I touch more kids than clergymen and get stuck inside of more heads than a narcoleptic brain surgeon. The plan is to collaborate music so good you can take the CD out of the cellophane and straight up masturbate to it. Musical like the animals, I'm the man in demand. Call me Jack Hanna Montana, Benny Tarzan.
And as we talked previously in the last episode about how good I felt like Benny Holmes was becoming, I was in this weird, like, cocoon phase, I would say, of, like, still trying to figure it out, and I was in between, you know, my rap styles. And this verse of mine I really did not like, and I was also very high when I wrote it and recorded it at Dollar Bill's house. And this was definitely one of the things where I can recall, man, like, I'm writing this, I'm high out of my mind, and I'm thinking, man, this is like the dopest shit ever. And then I listen to it after I'm sober, and I'm like, what the fuck was I talking about?
Walking, talking, weapon of mass destruction, putting that production out to mass consumption. I'm sick with it, but if being sick's a good thing, then bet I'm the cancer inside your throat you haven't found out about yet. I wanna destroy everything around me, goddamn, it's morbid. That boy's an asteroid headed for your planet's orbit, and you can try and survive, really you ain't able, dog. You're just a piece of wood that is headed for my table saw.
Smokey in my booth, I'm catching the contact. Let's keep the track burning, the mic still lit. Next up, two beat making geniuses, TJ Maxx and JD Kidd.
Now, Jada Kid was someone who I had heard about peripherally, I don't know, through JP from the HP. They both were beat-making rappers. They both grew up in Hazel Park together. And this was the first time I had ever been on a song with him. And so this is the first time I really heard him rap.
I grab the mic, explode like dynamite. Jada Kid, motherfucker, I give the game sight. Like light in the darkness, I'm bright. My flow's heartless, never trite. When I write, I am a true artist. Behind enemy lines, I spit venomous rhymes. I transform in an instant, just like Optimus Prime. Constantly on the grind, I give my all in this rap shit. I can't quit till my very last breath. I've never stopped this.
Damn, kid. We need to cop a new mic, this one's almost killed. Now next up, this kid usually don't take threats, but still, KRB, go ahead and take up all the pain.
So nonetheless, me and Benny Holmes were starting to get out there, collaborate with a lot of local artists, doing more shows. And I do think, even though I felt like the Kyle Resto, Louis Resto thing did not go how I wanted it to, right? It was the complete opposite of what I wanted. I think just the fact that we were associated with that did get us a lot of clout on the local scene. So people who may have never, you know, given us the time of day, we were suddenly, you know, getting more and more people wanting to work with us. And I started working with JP from the HP more. Me and him really just clicked. I mean, we had like the same sense of humor. I mean, we could get going on just some stupid fucking joke and we would just be dying laughing for like 2 hours straight. And we both were into conspiracy theories and sci-fi shit. And so he ends up getting me on a song for his Sucker Free Volume 1 album called Fucked Up World.
This fucked up world beats the heck out of me. The fuck out of me, God, I need a lobotomy. My cranium's about to combust. Give me some drugs or be somebody that I can trust. These sluts are two-faced, specialize in backstabbing. These dudes are savages, always wanna act bad. But when shit hits the fan, they hit the ground running. They talk shit behind your back to get the town buzzing. The state of the world is State Michigan. The cost of living is high with the wages minimum. And you can make it if you try real hard. But you're a setback to zero if you play the wrong card. Feathers, it ain't what you do, it's about who you know. Ladies, it ain't about school, it's about who you blow. Got no deal, so I'm fucked. Getting drunk and rapping, just another Will Smith. Stuck in the pursuit of happiness. People on the grind, caring is a waste of time. It seems that most of us are blind, and we should just open our eyes. It seems I'm always in a bind. So I'm drinking, getting high, to send my problems to the sky. Until there's nothing on my mind, cause I'm living in a fucked up world.
And just making this kind of music that JP was making, which was very, you know, had a lot of anger, but also this humor fused into it, and very aggressive, which he was already making, you know, before I even met him, before we even started working together. But this is kind of how I'm feeling at this time, based on how the previous year had went at this point, based on me feeling like things were just not working out, you know, that anger, you know, really started festering up a bit, and I needed an outlet for it. You know, when I was making the Stereo Killers album with Adam, I was trying to look for more of a positive messaging outlook. You know, I was really trying to be like the hero and, you know, being the good guy, making a lot of positive music, all this kind of stuff. And after things not working out and me just having a lot of resentment and anger, my music really began to start shifting. And this really is the beginning seeds of that.
These 50 states are full of snakes looking for deals. You will get killed from the same one you put in your wheel. They will cap you to pay their bills faster. Bury your body and go pay their bills after. The rabbis and pastors are in on it too, you know. They get paid for going to your funeral. In America.
people on the grind. Caring is a waste of time.
So just like it seemed like Kyle was bringing Adam, a.k.a. Benny Holmes, out of his shell a bit to his next level, to his full potential, and building a sound really around him and his style, I felt like the sound that JP was developing and producing was my style. That was the sound that I needed to reach my next level. And so him and I really started working together more, you know, really became close friends, started hanging out more. And like I said, you know, us having just the same sense of humor, being interested in a lot of the same things, that ends up, I think, tying people together a bit more than just music, which I think kind of becomes something to explain how things go later in the story. The third person on this track is a rapper named Pony Boy from Ferndale. Now, Pony Boy was from a crew of rappers in the Ferndale area that was led by longtime rapper Spit Vicious, who during the late 90s, what I would call the late 90s white rapper gold rush, when all the record labels were trying to sign the next big white rapper, because I think they all thought that the fatigue from Vanilla Ice had worn off, and they knew that if they got the right white guy up there, they could make millions and millions of dollars. And so around this time in the late 90s, you know, they're signing all these white rappers, and some of them don't have any music, don't have any musical history. There's this rapper named Hot Carl that they sign because they heard him rapping on the radio. Dude didn't even have a rap name. He got a record deal before he had a rap name, and he just came up with Hot Carl on the spot, and they gave him a $1 million record deal. And so they're signing all these people in the late 90s, and Spit Vicious was one of them. They gave him a deal from DreamWorks when DreamWorks was its own record label. And just pause for a second, because if I'm getting any of this information wrong, I apologize. I wasn't there. I was probably like 10 years old when all this shit is happening. But just, you know, going on from history, you know, this is just what I've heard and what I, you know, what I've read, some things that I do know maybe from a distance. So anyway, Spit Vicious gets signed in the late 90s to DreamWorks. And then, you know, 1998, Eminem gets signed by Dr. Dre. And Interscope, who's this gigantic record label that has historically, you know, bought up smaller labels, they end up buying DreamWorks, who had just signed Spit Vicious. And so because they now own DreamWorks and Spit Vicious is under them, to my understanding, you know, Interscope's like, hey, we only need one white rapper. We don't need the rest of these guys. So they end up dropping Hot Carl. They drop Spit Vicious. And I'm sure there's more that I don't even know about. So back to the main timeline of 2007, recording this song with JP. This is the first time I had ever rapped with Pony Boy, who was from this Ferndale crew led by Spit Vicious, and there was a whole, you know, other crew of rappers on there. But then Pony Boy comes in with the third verse.
It's a fucked up world. I'm living with a fucked up girl. She make me wanna up Chuck Earl. I don't trust sluts, even with a butt like a dump truck. She'll set you up, get you stuck playing butt putt. Dope songs, man, I've written many. Respect ain't getting any. I'm sipping Henny, sick of pinching pennies. Raise the windows like the White Widow. These haters wanna make my wife a white widow. Fuck technology, look at living qualities of any inner city, and in it you find inequalities. That's why I'm down for war on the cops. Fuck, I beef with this whore on my block, and she won't stop. Woke up and she cussing me out. My boy in jail, and we thinking about busting them out. We baking cakes with a file in it. It's a fucked up world that we living in. Boy, we gonna die in it.
People on the grind, caring is a waste of time. It seems that most of should just open our eyes. It seems I'm always in.
So JP is working on this Sucker Free Volume 1 album, and he's also created his own label called OMP, Only Means of Production, and it's also co-founded with Music Box, who's ran by a rapper named Alias. So JP is like, hey, you know, Stereo Killers, do you guys want to be part of this label? And, you know, because me and JP are clicking pretty well at this time, I'm like, hell yeah, I want to fucking, you know, be produced by this guy. Now that I know, like, how I feel like we mesh between his beats and me rapping, I want to make an album. I think, you know, Stereo Killers should have an album produced by him, at least some songs produced by him. So, you know, we end up deciding to be part of his label. And JP from the HP, who I would come to know this as a standard tradition of his, a standard part of who he is as an interesting individual, is he will have this big plan of saying, hey, we're going to do X, Y, Z. And then he just fucks off the fuck out of here, bro. So all of a sudden we go from, you know, hey, we got this, like, you know, local independent record label. You know, we're going to make music with some other local rappers. It's going to be this whole thing. And he decides that he's just going to move to Wyoming out of nowhere. So he just, like, one day calls me and he's like, dude, I just got to tell you, you know, I know that we were planning to make music together, but I moved to Wyoming. And I'm just like, you know, kind of like, okay. Like, I didn't feel like he owed me anything. Me and him just started being friends. And I by no means held him to any expectations that I felt with Kyle Resto. It was just, you know, a dude, you know, locally that I was making music with, that I was friends with. So to me, it wasn't like a big deal. I wasn't mad at him. I wasn't upset about it. It was just kind of whatever. I mean, again, after the whole Kyle Resto fallout and me feeling like I had lost everything, really, you know, it was just, there wasn't too much that could happen at that point to really upset me. So it was just kind of whatever. But it seemed like he felt bad for whatever reason. And so he's like, well, here's what's going to happen. So you never met Alias. He's the head of the Music Box side of OMP Music Box. So I talked with him, and he's going to take Stereo Killers under his wing, and you guys are going to be part of his label. And I'm like, all right, man, whatever. You know, I never heard of this Alias dude, but, you know, if we're going to have a home, a place to record, someone to produce us, that's really all that I was looking for at that point. And, you know, Stereo Killers was homeless. I mean, you know, we started out recording at Adam's house. The laptop got stolen. Boom. We're homeless. We don't have anywhere to make music. Then we start recording with Kyle Resto. Then he moves to Chicago. Boom. We're homeless. Then, you know, we're going to start working with JP. JP moves to Wyoming. Boom. We're homeless. And so it was just like we were just nomads. We were running all around. And I wasn't that upset about it because it was kind of cool at this time, us meeting all these new people and collaborating with all these people. And that's just, you know, part of the journey. And the more people you work with artistically, the more you actually find who you are artistically. So we go to meet Alias, and he lives in this condo. He opens up the door for me and Benny Holmes, and I see this dude with a neck brace on. And I'm confused. Like, I'm like, you know, is this dude seriously injured? You know, should he be in a wheelchair? Like, I'm just, I don't know, you know, what the hell this dude's deal is. But anyway, we come in, he sits us down, and Alias was and is a very serious dude. He's someone who is hard to, like, know when they have a sense of humor, when they don't. Like, he's just very serious, and he was super serious about hip-hop, what he thought hip-hop was. and where he thought hip-hop should go and what kind of hip-hop artist he wanted to work with. So he's talking to us and kind of vetting us, so to speak. And, you know, at the end of that conversation, he's basically like, all right, I think we can work together, so on and so forth. And he's telling us about this prodigy he has that he's trying to develop and, you know, help become a rapper. And so in my head, when he's saying prodigy, I'm thinking like it's like a 15-year-old or something. And for me, you know, being kind of still a young guy compared to everyone else I was meeting, because, you know, at this point, I'm still 18 years old. And, you know, Adam was 2 years older than me. JP's 4 years older than me. So a lot of these guys I'm meeting, especially, you know, Alias, a lot of JP's friends, Jada Kid, Dollar Bill, you know, all these guys are older than me. So I'm kind of feeling like the young one. So I was like, you know, maybe it wouldn't be bad to have kind of a little brother type to help mentor and stuff like that. So I'm just expecting, you know, this young kid that we're all going to help rap and everything like that. So first song me and Adam end up doing at Alias's house is a song called Miss the Bus. And I think this was like for some competition or something. But this was going to be part of the 1202 album that we were still trying to work on.
You know the best is D-O-N-Y still. Can't sleep on me, give them some NyQuil. Take me from hungry MCs, make them start more. Miss the bus and I wanna join our tour. On the battle scene, I'm so damn good they say. Rap and castration, taking manhoods away. And it's ironic, of course I know. I'm on your iPod, yet I can't afford my own. They say, don't forget the little people when you get your riches, man. Well, hell, y'all should get a little bigger then. And if I can make my business plan, reach the Midwest after Michigan, then I'll take the East, South, and the West. And when I'm globally known, then I can rest. Fuck no, I ain't sleeping till I'm a household name with aliens.
It's obvious that y'all missed the bus. Now you're trying to catch up with us. It's obvious that y'all missed the bus.
So now I'm starting to feel like me and Adam are getting on the same level again. You know, I think after working with JP and him kind of sparking something back in me and me just, you know, starting to kind of better develop what I was trying to do, you know, I'm feeling confident on this track. And I'm feeling like, hey, you know, this is going to be a Stereo Killers track again. You know, it does, if you listen to the beat, it sounds kind of similar to the kind of beats we were rapping over on End of the Beginning. So I'm pretty happy with this. And, you know, Adam comes in and he's spitting and he's killing it as well.
Now you're trying to catch up with us.
2 seconds too late, look like they overslept. 12 hours to rest, hasn't gotten them sober yet. Not his fault if he chooses to chase his tail and taste the palest of ale until his chases fail. Wasted stale and she's addicted to the sedative, which isn't her fault either, cause nothing is, it never is, it never ends. Nothing which consumes a room in his head, but on the first of every month it never has its rent. Walking around town like everything's great, with his music so loud he never thinks straight. And everybody wants to stare, but not one person wants to listen. Everybody wants to talk, but not one person wants to question. Everybody needs somebody's love and affection, but not everybody has the time to sit down and pay attention. Where does that leave him? Stuck like a blood clot, sitting at the bus stop bench. In his pocket's $1.50, and he holds it like his pride. Mouth closed, eyes wide open on his ride. When he gets it, he's gonna take it.
Being the last song that we ever recorded as Stereo Killers. But I really think it's the first song where we started becoming our own artist, and maybe subconsciously knowing that. This is, you know, me starting to embrace who Tony Payola is. And this is where Benny Holmes would say something that kind of became his trademark.
Magical is natural, the regular is casual. Animals aren't people, but people are only animals. See, he's no dipshit, he knows this shit. So here he'll just sit, so he don't miss this.
It's obvious that y'all missed the bus. Now you're trying to...
And so, even though this was a competition with this beat that the producer STG made, I kind of felt like, with this chip on my shoulder, I was like, you know, fuck them. Because, you know, we're better than anyone else in this competition. And even if he doesn't think so, I think so. So fuck him, and I end up just dissing him on his own beat.
Man or other species when I'm on these beats. STGs, too many producers, I'm sick of them all, honestly. You're just another brick in the wall, and if the dog game's the flow game, then let's get typical. Every day I put 16 on the digital. I live in a land where the fiends are the fans. Dreams are the plans, and I just need a chance to get my CT on where the party is. Put your hands up, I'm robbing the audience. And I'ma keep feeding off this generation. To stay up is a world-leading federation. I'm the chairman of the board, right here when I record. Got you bowing on your knees, swearing I'm the Lord.
It's obvious that y'all missed the bus. Now you're trying to catch up with us. It's obvious that y'all missed the bus.
So we're recording at Alias's. We're starting to meet more of the rappers that are becoming part of this label. So Jada Kid is now part of this. Alias also found this dude, Benefit, who is from this rap group called Basement Addicts out in Kalamazoo. Now he's becoming part of it. And I finally meet Plague, who was the 15-year-older, who I thought was 15-year-old, Prodigy that Alias was talking about and how he had been working with him, teaching him how to rap. And so we go to Alias's, it's me and Adam, and it's like, oh man, we're finally going to meet Plague. That's awesome. I'm excited. And, you know, I go upstairs to where everybody recorded. And Alias is like, all right, man, he's getting ready to record, so, you know, just be quiet. And it's like, okay, cool, you know, I'll chill while you guys record. And I go up there, and I just see this dude who looks like he's in his 40s, looks like he's in a biker gang, and I'm just confused. So I start looking around. I'm like, nah, this can't be the 15-year-old Prodigy, right? And so, you know, I'm, like, looking, I'm checking, and I go, you know, Alias, man. Like, okay, I see you got this dude here, but where's the Prodigy? Where's Plague? And he goes, this is Plague. And it's like, you'd think that you would give us some kind of, you know, warning or maybe just explain this guy a little better. But the way that he described him before I met him, I totally was expecting this 15-year-old kid. And instead, you know, it looks like a dude who was from Sons of Anarchy.
To be continued.